Panther got here just in the nick of time. What does that make us?
Big damn heroes, sir.
Ain't we just?
Wow, James. You've got some groovy moves, my friend.
Thank you, Mr. Avalon. Please call me Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
James, what are you doing? Get up.
How many times have I done this, please?
1,000, maybe 2,000.
Exactly. Now, the first and only time I ripped my pants got to be in front of all these white folk.
In a white boy sweater.
My bass and my drum spread all over this cold floor. Go get me a towel.
Yes, sir, boss.
Keep on back!
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 Keep on
back!
Keep on back!
Wakanda forever!
Hello and welcome to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM, the film and TV radio show where a handful of film enthusiasts shoot the breeze about all things film and television. I'm Marcus Acko, and I want to start off today's show by saying, I know it's a little bit late because it's been news that's been circulating a while, but we've been off for a bit. We want to use this opportunity to say, rest in peace, Chadwick Boseman.
David Campbell, and I too want to say, rest in peace, Chadwick Boseman. You're going to be missed. You went far too young.
Absolutely. I mean, I remember when I heard that news, heard the news, and it was literally I woke up. It was a Saturday. That bank holiday Saturday, woke up, looked at my phone, and the first notification on my phone was, I had to read it twice. It was the fact that Chadwick Boseman had died of, I believe, colon cancer.
Yeah, colon cancer.
And it was like, and you know how you see things, when something happens and you flash back and you see the pattern of various things that you had dismissed in the past, and you're wondering how you didn't see it at first. And it kind of struck me, because going back a few months before that, like good few months, half a year before that, this was around when COVID kind of started. That's almost been a year, half a year. There was an Instagram video that he put out, and it was basically him promoting, again, social, you know, the whole social distancing thing had just started. People had just been locked down, and he was using the opportunity to promote a project that a friend of his was on, like a clothing project. I can't remember exactly what it was, but when you watch the video, you saw how really skinny he was, and he was almost emaciated, right? And the comments of that video were flooded with, dude, are you okay? You don't look too well, and so on. And there was no real confirmation as to what was going on. There was sort of a back and forth about maybe he's ill, maybe he has COVID, and then other people saying, actually, no, maybe he's just preparing for a role. That's why he had to lose a lot of weight. And then other people were saying, no, you don't know Chadwick. If you had followed him from back in the day, he's actually a naturally skinny guy. He put on weight for Black Panther. And that kind of makes sense, right? You know, people right. like Christian Bale and whatnot, they fluctuate with their body weight in order to suit the role they're in. And then after that, Spike Lee's The Five Bloods got dropped with Chadwick Boseman in it playing a soldier in the Vietnam War. And that, you know, his I don't know, gait or his body shape kind of fit what it was, because obviously he's a young, lean soldier in there. So that kind of, well, okay, fair enough, that's what it was. He was skinny because he was playing a role. And then that drops, and it's sort of, I mean, he was age 43. He was born in 1976, 2020. He found out he had colon cancer 2016. The next thought then was, wait, hold on. 2016 was when he found out that he was ill. And then you go back through his work. And just as you and I were talking just before we started recording, looking at his looking at IMDb, looking at all his body of work, if we were to just discount, so we say 2016 is when he got the news. Now, IMDb obviously have the years that were the roles that he was in when they were dropped. Let's discount anything that was released in 2016, because we all know what the movie making industry is like. You can't just make a movie in the same year and drop it, big movies especially. I mean, you can, but you know what I'm saying. Some of those movies might have taken a couple of years to make. So let's discount things like Captain America Civil War, where he first popped up as T'Challa, Black Panther. Let's discount that because that was released in 2016. Let's say it took a year to make that movie and so on. We'll discount Gods of Egypt because, again, maybe another year before then. Message from the King, which is a great, brutal revenge action type or man on a mission type stuff. If you haven't seen it, go and check out Message from the King on Netflix. It's great. Again, 2016, let's discount that. Now, Marshall, where he plays Thurgood Marshall. That was dropped in 2017. That has actually been released as a fact that he had already had his diagnosis at that point. So there's Marshall. Then we have Black Panther, which was shot in 2016, obviously after Civil War, and then it got released in 2018. So he definitely had, he definitely knew he was ill at that point. We have Avengers Infinity War, Endgame, 21 Bridges, and then the Five Bloods, and then one that hasn't come out yet, which is Ma Raimi's Black Bottom, which is coming out soon. So that's going to be the last time anyone sees him on screen, I guess. And then you start to think all of these, and you think, the man made 7 or 8 movies while going through that and kept it so quiet. You didn't go back and watch every interview that he was in, and you think, wow, with the smile and the joy that he brought to people who loved him and watched him on screen, you could see that smile. And I always thought, every time I saw him in interviews and I saw him on game shows and stuff like Saturday Night Live and stuff, he always still carried that real gravitas about him. He's like, yes, he's T'Challa everywhere he was going, right? You couldn't pull that away. And now I'm just thinking, that was because look at what he was carrying behind him. He didn't want to say to anybody and didn't want to depress anybody. And yet he wanted to entertain people. And then, again, like I've said, all these things start falling into place. And I start to think, perhaps maybe that's the reason why, those of you who watched Avengers Infinity War, not going to go too much into it, no spoilers, whatever. He's one of the people who got snapped and obviously he snapped back and so on and so forth. Maybe that was the reason that happened. Maybe had he not had this diagnosis, had that not happened, T'Challa would have played a bigger part in Endgame. You see what I mean? You start to put all these things, these questions start to roll and you start to think, and it's like, it gets you to start questioning your mortality. And I know I'm going on a rant, and this is not what you're tuned in. You're all tuned in to listen to us talk about films and television shows, and I'm dipping all of you with that. But, what I would like to do is maybe in the next week or something like that, David, if this is okay with you, maybe we can the next couple of weeks, watch some of his movies, and our top five for next week or in a week's time would be top five Chadwick Boseman films. What do you think?
Oh, that's a good idea. That's a good idea, because I need to catch up with a few of myself. I mean, I have seen The Five Bloods, and obviously I've seen the Black Panther film and Infinity War and Endgame, but I could do with watching 21 Bridges, Message from the King, as you say, as well, but also Get On Up, which I still haven't seen, and it had been on my list to watch, I just hadn't gotten around to it. And I mean, he did The Kill Hole as well with Billy Zane and Tori Kittles, I think it was. So yeah, just to watch a bit of his earlier work as well. And he starred as Jackie Robinson in 42. It's a baseball game, which a baseball movie, but
yeah, I mean, that's the thing. It's like the rise of his career was basically representing, very big black or African American characters. Jackie Robinson, you mentioned. Get On Up, which was James Brown.
Brown, yeah.
Thurgood Marshall. And then to just cap the whole thing off, Black Panther. I mean, yeah, fictional, but still, Black Panther is like, he's the epitome of of African. So, I mean, he's the greatest African superhero. I'm going to say this now. People are going to argue and say, no, that's Blade. No, it's Hancock. Whatever. I don't care. Black Panther is the epitome. He's the king of all super. If you want to look at like Superman as being like the greatest superhero of all time, again, people are going to argue. People say Batman. It doesn't matter. If we're looking in terms of race, Black Panther is the king for when it comes to African, superheroes. And that's what he
played. American.
Well, T'Challa's not African American, but I just wanted to point out,
Okay.
Yeah. I know there are going to be tons of people who are like, what about the Caribbean? What about Jamaica? I'm like, okay, look, from African descent. Okay, know what.
Well, put it this way. I mean, if people are going to argue, ask them to name five African American, African descent superheroes. And I think they'll struggle to get past three.
Steel, played by Shaquille O'Neal. No, don't include him in that list. It's just because I remember the rant that, remember when Black Panther came out? You were on the show at that point.
Yeah.
When Black Panther came out, and I came on the show and I did I came in and I asked you guys. I was like, look, is it okay if I do a rant at this point about different? And it was because when Black Panther came out, there was this whole argument online about. Why is Black Panther given such praise and such is held in such lofty standards? Because there's got a black superhero in it, and the reason I was pissed, well, I was angry about that was because a lot of comparisons was like, look, you've had other black superheroes before, like Blade and Hancock and Steel, which is Shaquille O'Neal. And if you watch Shaquille O'Neal, say, I watched it back in the 90s, and I'll be honest, I liked it back in the 90s, but that's because I didn't know any better. I rewatch it, and like, come on, man, really? Has Ray J and has Richard Roundtree in it. But anyway, so we're going to do that. We'll do, in the next couple of weeks, we'll do top five Chadwick Boseman movies, top five favorite Chadwick Boseman movies. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm David Campbell.
This week, we're going to move on to another filmmaker, Tim Barrow, who's talking to us about his schizophrenic romance drama called Riptide. He'll be telling us all about it. And then we'll jump in to do my top five favorite films and TV shows, or not films, but TV shows that I've been binging this period. And David, if you have your top five as well, we can do that as well. If not, you can just share maybe top three of the
One thing I will say to the listeners is, obviously, our interview with Tim was done over Zoom. So please forgive us if you notice any dropouts. It's not our fault. Unfortunately, the connection to Scotland wasn't brilliant. So sometimes we had a little bit of difficulty.
I've got to give you kudos, producer David, because you worked hard to fix it. So, if it was me, I would have just said, yeah, let's just scrap it and get a second episode. But no, I wouldn't do that to Tim. Tim's a lovely director, actor, producer, and his film Riptide definitely needs to be championed. So I just wanted to put that out there. We're going to put details of the film in the show notes. But anyway, let's jump into film and TV news. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
And we have an actor, director, producer. Please tell us your name and the latest film that you are working on.
My name is Tim Barrow, and my new film is called Riptide.
Now, Tim, just before we start talking about Riptide, you were part of a film that we have been championing a lot for a couple of years, Guardians. You got to work with Mark Brown and Dave Whitney. They're friends of the show. We love their work. Tell us, how did you get involved with Guardians? And for those people who've watched the film, who do you play in Guardians?
Oh, I play Hugo, who is one of the lads who breaks into the house with disastrous consequences. It was an absolute joy to be part of. I love those guys. Mark's brilliant, and he's been making short films for a long time and some really cracking pieces. So I really wanted to work with him if possible. And David's a really good pal of mine who I've worked with in theatre and on screen. So it was tremendous fun. And when Mark sent me the script, I went, yeah, yes, please. Cool. Can I come and do it? That'd be great. And we shot in their amazing house in Limehouse. And it's terrific. And it's also for, it's crossing all sorts of different genres, but it really, really made me laugh.
Is this the first time you've worked with Mark, or have you worked on other projects with him?
No, I haven't worked with him before. I've always known his work, and I've seen lots of his short films. And I was living in London from 2005 to 2011, so I used to see Mark quite a lot, and go to short film nights and see what he was working on and chat with him, have drinks with him. And he's terrific, and he's someone who just gets stuff done. He's kind of prolific.
Absolutely, because he's a writer director. He's currently workshopping one of his horror comedies at the moment. Can't wait to have him back in the studio. But just wanted to touch on that a little bit, just to give him a little shout out as well. But let's focus on you, because you are a writer director in your own right, writer director actor, and you have a film called Riptide. Can you tell us, what is Riptide about?
Okay, so Riptide is a schizophrenia love story road movie. It's set in Scotland. It's contemporary. I'm an actor, yes, so I wanted to be in it. But also with the last film, I directed it too, wrote and directed it. So that made perfect sense as someone to drive the film into creation, but to be there constantly producing and making sure that actually happened. It was something that I certainly wanted to do. And now in terms of schizophrenia, it's kind of, I don't have any firsthand experience of schizophrenia, and none of the cast did either. So it was really important for us to go and research what schizophrenia is and what it isn't, and be aware of all the myths and stigma associated with it. So we worked for about 6 years researching, and one of the highlights of that was actually working at the Royal Edinburgh Hospital with people who stay there, and as well as people who work there in medicine, and understanding just what this condition is. It's kind of wrong to call it a disorder, because some people with schizophrenia don't see it as a disorder. We were saying, and also why we're doing it, I think film and art can be quite guilty of taking people's very personal stories and using them for their own purposes. So, and whilst we're doing that, we had to make sure that we're working with sensitivity and dignity, and also trying to tell something that's authentic but hopeful and positive. There's got to be a good reason for putting it out there into the world. And luckily, when we started screening it, we found that people really, really, really liked it and really wanted to talk about that. It felt authentic to them, and also then share personal stories of their own mental health history. So that's something amazing, and just shows, I guess, what film, if you strike a chord, it can actually do to audiences in some sort of, I don't know, doing some good or enlightening somehow.
And it's good that you mentioned how much time you actually researched it, because one of the points I was going to raise was the fact that you have sort of, when you talk about stories with schizophrenia, a lot of people complain that you don't actually get the right, there are certain tropes and certain ideas that are used for that particular subject matter. What did you find from other movies about schizophrenia are completely wrong compared to the research that you discovered?
Schizophrenia as defined is nothing to do with a split personality, and that's a real myth that's been built up in all sorts of ways. I mean, and you can see the fascination that filmmakers or artists have with that idea. It's very alluring, and of course there's stories to be told about people who assume different identities, or there's some sort of medical conditions that lead to that. But schizophrenia is very much about hearing voices. That's one of the biggest symptoms. Although now, I mean, it just shows how far medicine keeps developing, because I think there's some people who no longer recognize schizophrenia as one specific disorder or condition, and it's broken down into far more specific conditions. So, but as soon as you say to filmmakers, all right, it's principally about hearing voices, that automatically leads us to go, well, that's a really interesting way of telling stories, and it's ripe for trying to document in an auditory way someone's experience of the world when they're hearing voices, and it's mixed perhaps with memories, dreams, flashbacks, and that's something that really appealed to me as a filmmaker, this kind of collage of influences and voices and sounds and music leading to a sort of a really interesting way of telling the story. And also something that we found, it's far more likely that people experience auditory hallucinations as opposed to visual hallucinations. And possibly again in film, that's something, because it's a visual art that filmmakers previously have concentrated on, that people see stuff that isn't there or see characters talking to them who aren't real. And whilst that's true and it happens, it's kind of less common than the auditory side of things.
That makes sense. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell. And I've got a question for you, Tim. What was the genesis of this story? How did you come... how did you get the idea to do this film?
It came to me quite sort of fully formed, the idea of a schizophrenia love story. And that leads to going, well, I want to tell a hopeful story about this condition. But there's a couple of sort of motivations to that historically. So I live in the village of Roslyn, which is just south of Edinburgh. And just over the glen from us was somewhere called Roslyn Lee, which is a former psychiatric hospital. So for us growing up, it had this kind of mystique and allure to it. And we knew people who went there, worked there. So that was always something that kind of lodged in my mind from early on. And then I went to drama school down in London and graduated in 2001. I went to Drama Centre. And there was a play on at the time called Blue Orange. I don't know if you're aware of it. It's by Joe Pennell, who subsequently become a well-known screenwriter. But he told this story. He often had plays which were about mental health. And he told this fascinating story about a young black man's experience of being diagnosed with schizophrenia and being in hospital, but also the kind of the power structures at play there. So in terms of how you telling that story through the prism of race and racism, and also in a sort of crumbling, underfunded NHS environment, what's his experience like as a patient, but also what the doctor's experience is like as well. So it's a really fascinating, disturbing piece, and that had a massive impact on me. I thought, that's a fascinating story. I'm really interested in this idea of schizophrenia. And so we wind forward to 2012, when I had my previous film, The Space Between, which is an Edinburgh love story, and we were touring that around. I was thinking, yeah, I want to make another film. So what am I going to give 5 years of my life to, and what am I really fascinated by? And that's where the schizophrenia love story reemerged.
So it took you 5 years to come up with, to work on a story, work on the projects. Obviously, it meant that you got to shoot before COVID. What has that been like since you shot the movie until it's ready just before the lockdown?
We've had, probably like everyone in the country, huge ups and downs with COVID. So we know people who have passed away. Lockdown is doing very strange things to all of us. We have a 17-month-old baby, so that's been a huge beacon of hope and light for us. But it's been a real tough time. So in terms of actually having a film that you want to get people together to watch in cinemas, that meant that we had to shelve all our plans. And then things started to move online. So in July, we actually kicked off at a festival which had moved the bulk of its work online, and that was the Scottish Mental Health Arts Festival. So for us as Scots, and having this story, it was real important to screen with them. And it gave us a window of opportunity for a week in which anyone could watch the film at their leisure and then respond. And then there was a Q&A and all the groovy things of film festivals. And up until then, we didn't know if anyone was going to like the film or it was going to resonate with them or if they were really going to take against what we were doing or trying to do. And we discovered this tremendous feedback. It was wonderful. So that gave us a real spur to go, actually, good, this film is finding an audience who like it. So we're going to try and do more online screenings, but what we really want are cinemas. We want to bring people together and showcase the film where it's going to look and sound best. So that's why when as soon as cinemas started reopening in England, because Scotland was a wee bit delayed, a wee bit after, we contacted Genesis and said, we're so excited about coming to London and screening. So the film's got a screening at Genesis Cinema. They were really excited about showcasing it. And we just can't wait to show the film on a big screen where it looks and sounds best and do a Q&A afterwards and really get a sense of what an audience is making of it there. And also the thing with, like I was talking about earlier, with this idea of creating soundscapes and having auditory hallucinations and doing quite expressive stuff with sound, of course, in a cinema, that's going to hopefully be extraordinary. And that's really what we want to find out about.
Excellent. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
And we're talking to writer, producer, director, actor, Tim Barrow about his new film, Riptide, which is a love story, as a schizophrenia love story. Now, I mentioned all of those credits that you had for this particular project. Obviously, you're juggling so many hats on a film set. What kind of tips would you give to aspiring filmmakers who are looking to dive into filmmaking, who are considering juggling acting, writing, directing, producing? What did you find was the hardest part of doing all of that? And what did you find were some of the techniques that allowed you to be able to deal with that?
Firstly, people have just got to make films. So from whatever your standpoint is, whether you're directing or writing or acting or doing lots of it, just go and make them. If you've got a story you're burning to tell, go and tell it, find a way. It is a tremendous experience. It's a huge learning curve making your first film or your 90th film. And you get to work with the most wonderful people. So I love working with composers and sound people and makeup, as well as cinematographers and other actors. It's very hard to wear all the other hats and know what's required of you at any specific time. But with film, it takes a long time to make, so you can break it up more easily. On set, I guess, the acting and directing is the balance that you've got to strike, but you've got loads of people around you who can help out with that. So our cinematographer is a guy called Robbie Jones, and Robbie's terrific. He's very talented, but he's got a great film mind, and so he was on board since the beginning looking at scripts. He actually persuaded me after an initial draft to make the film because it was a daunting prospect. And I thought, well, it's what point? And really persuaded me it was a good idea to attempt it. So you wind forward a few years after we've done research, we've got our scripts and we're on set, and he's someone who's able to look at performance and say, okay, Tim, I think we've got it. Or maybe we should go again, strictly in terms of performance. And that's incredibly helpful. But also being an actor, I'm used to being surrounded by an ensemble of actors, and we all kind of help each other out or have bits of advice. So I knew that territory. And having seen a film through from origin to completion in our previous film, The Space Between, whilst wearing those hats, producing, writing, directing, acting, I knew I could do it. Theoretically, I knew I could do it. So that massively helped as well. But I think film's a collaborative process. So if you find all those people, if you're a new filmmaker, or whatever stage of career you're at, it's all about the people you're working with. Everyone's going to make each other look good. Everyone's hopefully going to bring their best work and talents to the table. And hopefully you're making something that you're all fully invested in and really proud of at the end of it.
It's a great endeavor to be able to tackle all of those things at the same time. The last time I ever tried to do that, I almost had a nervous breakdown. So I have respect for all the people who are willing to jump at that. As you said, you had your screening, you're having your screening at Genesis. What's going to happen going forward? How do the rest of the audience who aren't able to make it to the Genesis, how will we be able to see this movie?
We wanted to do a lot of cinema screenings. Unfortunately, COVID had other ideas. So this Genesis screening is very much dipping the toe in the water and seeing, okay, what's this experience like and how's it going to work? So in Scotland, our cinemas have only just opened, and the reports about COVID are not good. We know the infection rates keep going up, so we might be facing a situation where cinemas have to close again, which would just be dreadful. So I think with us, we've got a few more festivals in the autumn. These are all online. They're all in the US as well. So we've got one in Chicago and one in Florida, and one which is very much a virtual thing. Usually they have screenings in New York and LA, but this is purely a virtual thing this time in November. So there will be opportunities online to log in and view stuff, but I think it'll be probably next year, hopefully next spring, before we're actually bringing the film back to cinemas.
Yeah, because you obviously have to allow COVID to run its course and allow people to be confident enough to go into the cinemas. Otherwise, you have to watch it online. And that's one of the things that we've been experiencing with a few filmmakers. We had Tom Payton, who came on the show, and he did one of his virtual screenings for one of his movies. So how can we get the link? Are we going to be able to get a link to be able to watch one of your virtual screenings?
I think so. If it's cool with you, I mean, you can find all the info at our website. So that's riptidethefilm.co.uk. And I'd love to keep you updated with what we're doing. Hopefully that's cinema screenings at some point very soon, more of them. But it will probably be a case of going, we're screening these festivals in October and November. So if people are really keen to check out the film, they can watch them that way. As long as the festivals are doing stuff, a worldwide thing. And if not, I mean, if depending on what happens with COVID, we might be forced to, or not forced to, but to, we might have the opportunity to put the film online and people can watch it on YouTube or Vimeo on demand straight away. Because that probably won't detract from cinema screenings, because we will do them next year at some point when it's safe.
And we're absolutely happy to help in any way that we can. We're going to be putting the link to your website, to the links on all our social media, as well as the show notes for the podcast when it goes out. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell. And I'd just quickly like to just ask, you're an actor-director, but you're also a playwright as well, aren't you?
I am, yes.
And I know that you did one play in particular called, was it Act of Union or Union?
And that was a few years ago. That was 2014. And in Scotland, we had a independence referendum in 2014. So I had the script kicking about for a few years, and it was staged at Lyceum Theatre here in Edinburgh. And it was called Union. And it was because I didn't know anything about how Scotland and England were joined in the Act of Union in 1707 and all the sort of political chicanery that went on then and what was going on and all the historical figures, like the Londoner Daniel Defoe was up in Edinburgh working as a spy for a faction in the English Parliament and all this like really juicy dramatic stuff. And we had Queen Anne who was on stage who was gay, but had also suffered 17 miscarriages. So all this really horrific stuff. And we put it on stage and it was terrific. It was a brilliant thing. It was an absolute joy to be part of. And it felt like a good thing to do, that we should know our history about how Great Britain was formed in 1707 and who was for it and who was against it. Because it can only shed light on what's going on now in current days.
Karen. This is the problem of being on Zoom. You don't always get the visual cues about when and who's going to speak. So carry on, Mark. Yep. Sorry.
Oh, no, all I was going to ask was, as you've done, so you're a playwright, you've also now moved into cinema. All I was going to ask was, are you planning on going back to the stage? I know, obviously, COVID is preventing stage plays to be put on. Is there a plan for you to, I guess that could come into the what's next for Tim Barrow. Are you looking at doing more stage work, or are you looking to do more in film and cinema? What is next for Tim Barrow?
Oh, I want to do everything. But in terms of what's on the ground, next year is going to be, I think, pretty exciting in terms of taking Riptide out and about. So more festivals, more cinema screenings, stuff online, bringing out DVDs, Blu-rays. So as a producer, that's going to probably keep me pretty busy. In terms of theatre, God, yeah, there's something we've done at the Edinburgh Fringe for the last 2 years. It was cancelled this year, of course. We performed a site-specific play at a football stadium. So Heart of Midlothian, one of the football teams in Edinburgh. And we performed a play called The War of Two Halves. And this was set in 1914. And you had a football team of Hearts who were chasing the title. And they had a great team. But then First World War happened. And the bulk of this squad volunteered to go and fight in the trenches. And lots of them never came back. So we did a site-specific retelling of that story. And that was, without doubt, the best theatre experience I've ever been part of. Because you had people who were related to these people come and see the show. You're dealing with football fans, so they know the story. It's their stadium. They know the pitch. They come into the dressing rooms. They go and see a First World War trench. So we're going to stage that again next year. And we're also, we've got a show about women's football, which is cast of women telling the story of how the football authorities banned women's football in 1921. So 100 years later, we tell that story. So again, we do a story with songs and with music and with all these, I don't know, six or seven female actors kind of multi-rolling and telling the story of women playing football back in First World War.
It's an exciting story, Tim, that you come back. It's great to see that you are not daunted by what is happening in the world around us, because we're hearing news about, various like stage plays being shut down. We're hearing, the film industry is trying its best to reboot, trying to get back in and do things, only to have certain setbacks. I mean, we heard recently about the Batman production having to shut down because someone from the cast contracted COVID. There are rumors as to who it was, but it's sort of, if the big boys are experiencing that sort of a punch, independent filmmakers such as yourself obviously are straining to be able to do that as well. What is your plan of attack to be able to say, look, I'm not going to let this get me down. I'm going to carry on with my project. What are you planning on doing for your future projects?
I think in the indie world, people can move a bit faster and we can adapt quicker, probably because we have to and there's less money. So in terms of shooting another film, my cinematographer, Robbie Jones, is currently on set filming something today, the first time in ages. And of course, they've got safety precautions and everything, but it's showing that it is possible with a tiny crew to go and do stuff. So it might be that we decide next year, if we don't have a particularly great winter and we go into lockdown or all the sort of dreaded stuff, which I really hope doesn't happen, and I kind of think it won't. I don't want to tempt fate. We can conceivably start shooting stuff next year, if that's what dictates. If we can, we'll stage some theatre shows, which we've kind of got ready to go. And I think, hopefully, say we don't get in cinemas for a wee while, okay, fine. We'll keep on with these virtual film festivals, and then we might do our own things about bringing people together and hosting watch parties, or sort of having filmmaker Q&As online, or having panel events to do with people in the field of schizophrenia. There's quite a lot of possibilities, aside from actual cinema screening. So I hope we get to the cinemas. That's really what I want to be doing next year. But if not, there's fallback plans. And I guess artists in these times have proved how adaptable they can be in the face of all this kind of tragedy and strangeness.
And we do our best to help you out as best as we can. David, go for it.
Yeah, sorry. I was just going to ask, have you got anything in the pipeline now that you're researching for a new film?
Yeah, there's a few bits and pieces. I don't want to be too specific, but since we've been doing research into mental health conditions and psychosis, there's other stories which have emerged which I'm drawn to, and particularly from people, whether they're people who have experienced psychosis or people who work with them. So I'm, I guess, like a lot of people, I've been really struck by just the magnificence and strength and dedication of nurses during these times. So nurses who work with psychiatric patients or nurses who work with the police or judiciary, I'm interested in some stories there. So there's a lot of research going on at the moment in terms of those things. It does take, in terms of doing justice to them, it'll take quite a while to keep researching and writing. So I don't have anything sort of oven ready at the moment. But Riptide is, and a little 17-month-old baby is keeping me incredibly busy at the moment.
Yeah, that's your man. Yeah, exactly. That's a big project that you're working on at the moment. That's the what you have that you're going to be using the next few months to grow and flourish and make its announcement into the world. If people want to follow you on social media, how can they do that?
Oh, they can check us out on Facebook. So we've got Riptide. That's a group. So we keep posting all the new stuff in there. They can check out our film website, which thank you for promoting that. And also on Twitter, the specific Riptide handle is at Jacob and Eva. That's our two main characters in the film. So we'll, and on Instagram as well, we're Riptide the film. So we'll just, we're Lara Films. So we'll just keep spreading the messages in those ways and just seeing how we can go. But I do appreciate this. Thank you very much. It's lovely to talk to you. And it's great that you're able to give a platform to an indie filmmaker like me as well.
Just for people out there listening, the film website is riptidethemovie.co.uk.
Riptidethefilm.co.uk.
Sorry, I've been watching too many American films. And it's,
I was just about to give producer Dave the props that he was like, he's on it, he gets things done, and just he went and stumbled in the last second.
Yeah, okay, well, you know, these things happen.
So, okay. And Tim, we were happy to sort of promote, to do as much as we can to make sure that your film reaches as many people as, especially in these times, but even before these times, we're happy to help as much as we can. As soon as we are able to get back in the studio, we'd love to have you come in, sit down with us, talk about all the future projects that you have going on, and even some back projects as well, and give us more goss and more stories that you can tell us about Mark Brown and Dave Whitney. Dave Whitney's in Riptide, isn't he?
He is indeed. I absolutely love him as an actor. There's no one like him. And he's brilliant. He's got great quality. And he plays a psychiatrist in this film.
Yeah, Dave Whitney's a larger-than-life character. Did he try at any point to play the bagpipes in your film?
No, he didn't. But I got married in September and he was the best man. And we didn't ask him to play the pipes, which he does because he had plenty of other things to do. And we thought he might want to enjoy the later part of the evening. But one of the final moments of the wedding was him on stage grabbing the pipes from one of the pipers and playing some tunes. So any chance he'll get, yeah.
Absolutely. That's why I was wondering. It was like, you know, he would be suggesting. If I were him, I would have suggested, I can, you know, do this particular session character, but while I'm tuning my bagpipes at the same time. I just come back from a show, and so I didn't have time to drop it, and so let's do this as well. But that for a lot of people who aren't fans of bagpipes, are like, thank you. Otherwise, we wouldn't have watched this movie. Thank you very much for joining us, and like I said, as soon as you get the opportunity, we'd love to have you back on the show.
Oh, I'd love that. Thanks, Marcus and David. It's great talking to you.
Great talking to you as well.
So that was Tim Barrow talking about Riptide. Like I said earlier, we're going to put in links to his social media and how you can find out more about the film in the show notes, which will be coming out as a podcast on Monday. And if you want to follow him on social media, do so. Follow us on social media. We'll post all his details and let you know more about the film. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. And now it's time for Top 5 Favorites. So this week, I came prepared. I'm kidding. I had to take that shot. No, producer David has been working real hard trying to work through COVID and not that you have COVID or whatever, but all the limitations caused by the pandemic to get this show into your ears and for you to listen to me babble on about the films that I like. So I'm going to use this opportunity to do my top five favorite TV shows that I've been watching in the last few weeks that I am binging, and I highly recommend that you all watch. And I'm going to start from five and go down to number one. And my number five that I put on the list is Cobra Kai. Now, if any of you grew up with the Karate Kid movies from back in the 80s about Johnny, who is taught by Mr. Miyagi how to fight against Johnny. Well, no, I keep calling him Johnny. It's not Johnny, it's Danny. Danny LaRusso. I don't know why I kept calling him Johnny. Danny LaRusso battling bullies in the valley, and he's trained by Mr. Miyagi to be able to win the martial arts contest. Anyway, we fast forward. The show starts. It's a two-season show so far that is on Netflix. It was on YouTube before, YouTube Red, I believe, but they've now moved it onto Netflix. And the story follows on, not following Danny as the protagonist anymore, but instead following that's why I keep calling him Johnny. Following Johnny, who is Johnny Lawrence, who was the one that was beaten by Danny LaRusso at the end of the first film. You know, the one with the crane kick. And if you remember the crane kick, Johnny Lawrence is the one who gets kicked in the face and he loses the battle. And the show starts from that point with a time jump to 30 years later, where you now see Johnny working as a janitor / handyman, if you will, and his life has pretty much gone down the pan while Danny LaRusso's has skyrocketed and so on. And it's a great comedy. Cobra Kai, you need to check it out. It's on Netflix. I binged watched season one in a day. Each episode is about 30 minutes long maximum, and they're about, 10 episodes a season, something like that. I binge watched the entire first season in one day. I'm quite proud of that because it is it's fantastic. Johnny set reignites the Cobra Kai dojo, and he starts getting bullied kids coming in, and he's training them, but obviously not in the Mr. Miyagi technique, but in the way Cobra Kai would train them. And that's why it's so good. He's an anti-hero, but he's fantastic. Cobra Kai, recommend you go and see it. Number four for me, Umbrella Academy. I've talked about it nonstop. I binged watched the second season in 2 days. So not as about two and a half days. Umbrella Academy follows five or six kids. I can't remember exactly how many kids. And they were all born on the same day. They were adopted by a mysterious rich man who has intentions to utilize them because he discovers that they all have superpowers. And he cultivates them into what is supposed to be a superhero team. The first season ends the first season begins with the death of the father. And the kids who have all pretty much been scattered across the earth or whatever and beyond have to come together for the funeral. And one of the children has gone missing, but before, obviously, and the child comes back to kickstart the action. And it's fantastic. The child is referred to as number five because that's how the dad named all of them. And it's a highly imaginative TV show. It's from a graphic novel of the same name. Second season is just as good as the first season because while they still keep the characters, they keep their motivation, their style, etc., they shift time, if you will. And it's the same wacky, unpredictable nature of the show, but in a different setting. And it still works. It's still very, very good. Go check it out. Umbrella Academy.
Yeah, well, I've been watching that as well. I'm not as far ahead as into it as you are. It brings to mind to me X-Men because of the setup, but you get rid of Professor X right away in a sense. But also one of the features that I like about it is the fact that you see both young and old, but one character remains the same throughout. And I thought that was a really interesting twist. I really like that as well. For musos out there and for people star spotting, check out Mary J. Blige because she's in this as well. And you need to see her. She's another musician who's gone into acting and she's starting to get really good props in it. She was nominated for an Oscar for a film she did not too long ago. I can't remember the name of the film and I still need to see it. But yeah.
Was she Mudbound or was that nuts?
I'm looking to check out some of her stuff because yeah, she's pretty good. So yeah, Umbrella Academy. Yeah, I'm kind of like watching through that as well, but not at the speed of Marcus.
Yeah, well, I doubt anybody can compare. Not anyone. I'm not gonna brag. But it's not healthy the way I consume television films. It's not because you should all have lives that you live properly. But you know, don't do like I do and consume it the way I do. But I don't think you can challenge it. Okay, so I'll move on to my number three. My number three is currently on Sky, on Sky Catch Up, or if you have Sky, you can check it out. It's called Lovecraft Country. Lovecraft Country is set in the 50s, and it follows a young African American Marine or soldier comes back from the Second World War, comes back from the battle in Japan. Japan, right? Yes. Anyway, he comes back. Obviously, we're talking South, we're talking American racism, etc. And he comes back to go and find, he's in search for his missing father. And he goes on a road trip with his uncle and a childhood friend to go into what is referred to as Lovecraft Country, which is kind of the deep South America. And if you're familiar with any of, is it H.P. Lovecraft? I keep
messing. H.P. Lovecraft, yeah.
If you often hear the terms Lovecraftian. Tom Patton, when he comes on the show, always talks about his earlier movies being Lovecraftian, where monsters and gigantic creatures coming out of from different dimensions and from hellscapes, etc. This TV show is full of that. In fact, it kicks off the episode. The first episode kicks off with kind of a dream sequence, and it's not me. It's not difficult to see it as a dream sequence because he starts off as a soldier. He's in the trenches, he's battling people in the trenches, and he climbs out of the trench, goes on top, and the first thing he sees when the wide scape of the battleground is massive tripod type aliens from War of the Worlds, and a massive gigantic monster jumps out and an alien drops down to come and rescue him. And then another demon tries to come and get him and is smashed to bits by Jackie Robinson with his bat. And that's just the start. It's a great show. I'm three episodes in. But at the start of the third episode, my thoughts immediately went to American Horror Story, where American Horror Story, each season, it kind of focuses on a different style of, different style of horror movie trope. And they focus with the same actors playing different characters. I thought that was the way they were going. It's not, but it's great. Full of ethnically African American actors. You have Jada Harris. You have Jurnee Smollett. You have Courtney B. Vance. Michael K. Williams. Those of you know Michael K. Williams from The Wire. Anything he's in, I think he's amazing. And I ranted about Courtney B. Vance recently on another film that he was on. I love him. I grew up watching him completely. And he's got Wumi Mosaku. You'd recognize her face. She's a British actress. You recognize her in a lot of stuff that she's been doing. And she pops up in this flawless American accent. That's my number three, Lovecraft Country. My number two is a doubleheader, Mr. Mercedes and Mercedes. Mr. Mercedes is based on a Stephen King novel, and it follows sort of a dichotomy. Well, it follows two storylines. It follows a psychopathic killer who starts off, the TV show starts off with the killer getting into a Mercedes and crashing into a group of people, killing about 18 of them. And then the story jumps about 3 years forward where still haven't caught him, and he follows the investigator, the detective who's now retired, played brilliantly by Brendan Gleeson, and he's trying to track it. So it's three seasons long. Check it out. It's on Stars, which you can get on Amazon Prime. The other one is Undone, which is on Amazon Prime. It's kind of animated. It's just nicely styled animation, and it's about this woman who's afraid of having sort of contracted schizophrenia, kind of tie into our interview today. She's afraid that she's going to have schizophrenia because her grandmother was diagnosed with schizophrenia, and she thinks it's gone down the line. But this is all kicks off when she has an accident and she starts seeing her dead father. And her dead father is talking to her and telling her that she can actually turn time or play around with time, jump back in time, and he wants her to go back in time and find out who killed him or why he got killed. And it's very, very funny, but very touching. And the animation style is good. Don't worry about the animation style. The animation style is mainly there to be able to allow for them to be able to play around with the way the story progresses. But it's called Undone. It's one season. I'm almost at the end. I've got one more episode to go. It's a great show. So that's my number two, Mr. Mercedes and Undone. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
David, do you have any other TV shows that you want to recommend really quickly just before?
Very quickly. I'm going to go back and recommend Ragnarok again. I actually watched it again in bits. And I actually do think it's a really, really good show. Kind of throws out the superhero trope, puts it on another level. And actually, to be quite honest, the storyline... does relate to what we were talking about with Tim, someone with a condition that he needs to manage. And but throughout that, finding that he's got superhero powers, or discovering towards the end that he's got superhero powers and not being as totally whack as people have been trying to intimate. So yeah, that Protector, I've been watching that as well. I'm catching up with that and a few other bits and pieces on Netflix. So Lovecraft Country is one of those on the list. It's in my list of bits and pieces to watch on Netflix. And that list is growing bigger and bigger and bigger. And I'm still, you know, with 10 episodes per series, sometimes it's gonna just get bigger and bigger and bigger. So, you know.
I'm just going to tell you, take Lovecraft Country off the list and inject it into your veins immediately, because it is amazing. It's a great show. You need to check it out. Anyway, my number one, I've been ranting about this. Anytime I talk about it, I rant about it. So I'm not going to talk too much about it because obviously we need to wrap up. The Boys. It's on Amazon Prime. It's got Carl Urban in it. It's got Simon Pegg was in the first season. It had Elizabeth Shue as well. She's in it. And it's from the graphic novel written by Gareth Ennis, and the TV show is created by the same person who did Supernatural. It is violent, it is sweary, it is awesome. Check out The Boys. Second season is just dropping episode after episode. Episode 5 is dropping tonight, Friday. It's dropping today. I'm going to be watching the episode. You've been listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I want to thank you all very much for tuning in, staying with us, listening to us rant about TV shows and movies and whatnot. I've been Marcus Iacco.
I'm David Campbell. I'm going to just quickly point in one more thing that I've been watching, and it's just popped back into my mind. Doom Patrol. How could I forget about Doom Patrol? It's one of those programs that I really, really enjoyed. The disparate characters that are involved in there and the storylines are just mad. And it's on season 2 at the moment, that's available. There is going to be a season 3. There's got to be a season 3 because it is just so wonderful. Such a brilliant show.
I agree 100%. I was going to put it on my list, but I was going to put it with Mr. Mercedes, but then I just caught Undone. That's why I wanted to put that on there. Anyway, I've been Marcus E. Hackle.
I'm David Campbell.
Thank you very much for listening, and
see you all next week, or hear you all next week.